I'm honoured to welcome Bishop Kevin Dowling here from South Africa, where, as I'm sure so many of you know, he is always prepared to speak out on behalf of his people. Bishop Kevin has talked many times of how he came to focus on human rights issues through what he's called a conversion experience when he was a young Redemptorist priest working in townships and then went to Cape Town. He became part of the anti-apartheid movement, helping civic and political activists with space to meet at his mission in Cape Town. And it was there that his mission church was blown up. He also led a peaceful protest of thousands of people. Soldiers opened fire. They nearly killed him, and they shot dead a student next to him, something that he later testified about to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. The end of apartheid in South Africa has not led, of course, to the end of its problems, and Bishop Kevin has been devoting himself since to the fight against two other great enemies of the people, poverty and HIV/AIDS. He's now been a bishop for nearly 25 years in Rustenburg, and he is, I think it's fair to say, exactly the kind of pastor that Pope Francis wants us to have when he urges priests and bishops to smell the sheep. Bishop Kevin, you're very welcome.
So good evening, my sisters and brothers, my fellow people walking on the journey of life. It's a tremendous privilege for me to be here this evening, and I want to thank the editor of the tablet, Catherine Pepinster, for inviting me to give this lecture. I'm so pleased that so many of you have come out with the other attractions like Wimbledon and the World Cup. But I hope that what I share with you this evening will simply be an inspiration for you to continue your own faith journey and commitment in life. We open our doors to everyone, even though they might come in to kill us. Those words were spoken less than 3 weeks ago, on Sunday, 8th of June, by a soft-spoken Syrian-born Jesuit priest, Father Murad, whose gentle eyes also revealed oceans of suffering and trauma that he has personally experienced in homes in Syria. He said this during the Pax Christi International Peace Award ceremony in a church in Sarajevo, Bosnia-Herzegovina. That evening, I was privileged to give the Jesuit Refugee Service Syria the Pax Christi Peace Award for 2014, together with my co-president Marie Dennis from the United States. Earlier that day, we had listened to two Syrian Jesuit priests, Father Murad and Father Ziad, describe the horrendous suffering in that protracted war, and their work with Jesuit Refugee Service in Homs and Aleppo, where both of them have remained in spite of the assassination of a brother Jesuit priest in April this year. They have stayed with their people and are witnessing to nonviolence and peace together with scores of Muslim and Christian peace activists with whom they work in providing humanitarian relief, education, healthcare, and above all, hope. But as he said, we open our doors to everyone, even though they might come in to kill us. And we will never stop opening our doors. We can only find our safety in God. Now, I share that story, that experience with you in the hope that it will be part of the terminus ad quem, the closure of this address tonight. My hope is that even though the title of this address has been formulated as from South to North, Lessons for the Church from the Developing World, At the end, we will hopefully be united in the awareness that in God's eyes, there is not a world of north and south, but one world entrusted to all of us by God, and that what we in the south can offer to a dialogue is simply what we have experienced and perhaps have learned from our own encounters with our people who suffer poverty, violence, and misery. And that what is required of all of us is that we in the South and those in the North, especially in the church, invite each other to mutual accountability in terms of what we commit ourselves to from our learnings and the ways we will try to transform our world and the people entrusted to us. Pope Francis is continuing to articulate a shift in the way church can and should be understood theologically, but above all, should be experienced in its praxis, in this one world with all that threatens it. And I also believe that the ever surprising little gems of insight and comment that we receive from Pope Francis week by week are all part of a continuum in his own experience of personal conversion and of being evangelized by the poor in the poverty-stricken reality in which he ministered in Argentina, and which continues today in the way he lives his calling to be the pastor pope for everyone, but especially the most vulnerable, the poorest, and most downtrodden of the earth. That moment when he called for his vehicle to stop and he got out and gently laid his head in prayer against the wall dividing Palestinian from Israeli. Well, that gesture would have spoken more than thousands of words to the Palestinians in the occupied territories about his active and caring solidarity with their suffering. But then later, he was also inclusive of those who had suffered in the Holocaust. And this was followed by his call to Presidents Abbas and Peres to come to Rome to meet each other as fellow human beings, to pray together with Pope Francis for peace, the symbol of which was the planting of an olive tree. I think these gestures and words reflect the shift Pope Francis desires to see unfold in the theology and praxis of the church in the reality of the world of today, and which we can only hope is touching some out there in the world and causing them to think again about the global context of poverty and suffering and about our future as human beings and the future of our planet. In the apostolic exhortation Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel, Francis called for a church community which will be characterized not by an inward-looking focus on churchy concerns, but by the twin focuses of missionary discipleship and a church with the poor and suffering at the center of its life and praxis. And in this, he's clearly articulating a truth that we as Catholics, as church, we cannot live our faith ahistorically. Faith, theology, and church praxis must be lived and expressed in the socio-historical context as it actually is, with all the questions and challenges that this context places before us. And in this regard, Pope Benedict, reflecting on the experiences of the African church in the document Africae Munus, issued a strong caution about what he termed the falsehood of withdrawal or evasion present in a theological or spiritual speculation which could serve as an escape from concrete historical responsibility. And this is where I would like to begin with some of the experiences and learnings I will try to share from my life and ministry in the Global South in terms of this ideal of a living theology and praxis in the socio-historical context of the time. I come out of an experience of being born a white South African in the context of the vicious system of apartheid. The shift in appreciating the horrors of apartheid and what it did to our people occurred when, after returning to South Africa from my seminary studies here in England, I was posted to three impoverished communities on the Cape Flats in Cape Town as a young priest of 26. For the first time in my life, I was actually living with the poor and oppressed in shocking conditions. It was a deep personal conversion experience for me, a real experience of being evangelized by the poor and downtrodden of God's earth among whom I was living. I had to relearn everything I had been taught in my life till that moment about faith, about spirituality, about theology, morality, ethics. For example, decision-making in politics and economic policies as these affect the quality of life of the poor and vulnerable. I had to relearn all this, and I had to rediscover also what the mission of the church actually means in the context of people's lives, what evangelization should mean and promote in the living context of people's lives today. Only later would I discover the richness of theological reflection on the structural causes of poverty, injustice, wars, violence, and everything else which dehumanizes the individual and the family and the communities. The richness of doing theology at the coalface, and not only in academic institutions. It was a discovery about the various forms of contextual theology, which I believe the developing world can share in humility. Contextual theology, which in Latin America was termed liberation theology. Contextual or liberation theology begins from deep listening to the poor and oppressed as they analyze their situation, and then moves on to theologize about the signs of the times as experienced by the poor in relation to the Word of God. And then, from there, to the denunciation of the systemic injustice in all its forms, coupled with a commitment to transform the root causes of poverty and injustice. And finally, to proclaim and offer a word and an experience of hope which will enable those who suffer so much to find that inner strength for the long journey to overcome the effects of poverty and injustice in their lives. And in terms of the mission of the church, it comes down to the magnitude of the question: how can I, as a person of faith, how do I tell people mired in poverty, misery, and injustice that God loves you? How can I enable people suffering so deeply to actually believe that God loves them? How can I do this in a way which will empower them as agents of their own transformation of the suffering they endure? How can that proceed from an experience, God loves me and sends me to transform this? Yes, it was in 1971, 1 year after I went to those parishes in Cape Town, that the groundbreaking work of Gustavo Gutierrez was published, A Theology of Liberation, History, Politics, and Salvation. Everything he and his colleagues have written can deepen our understanding of a theology and mission of the Church, an evangelization which promotes the liberation of people, families, and whole communities, but in their socio-historical context. Now, the insights of liberation or contextual theology have been further enriched by the developments of Catholic social teaching over the past years. In modern social teaching, there have been several significant shifts also, but the basic ones are captured in Octogesima Adveniens in paragraph 4. Firstly, a move from the contextual to the universal. A move from an emphasis on charity to justice. As Augustine remarked, charity is no substitute for justice withheld. An inductive method to a deductive method. And finally, a move from a reliance on natural law to an integrated theological approach. In terms of this integrated theological approach, it was a wonderful gift in my life as a bishop when I spent a week in El Salvador in March 2005, participating in theological reflections and witness by theologians and campesinos, the poor rural people, remembering the dreadful atrocities committed by the military regime, which included the assassination of Archbishop Oscar Romero. Another mentor in my life as a human being, a Christian, and above all as a bishop. That weekend in El Salvador marked the 25th anniversary of his assassination, and I will never forget the wonderful reflection one afternoon by those two great liberation theologians, Gustavo Gutierrez and John Sobrino, the Jesuit, as they engaged in a dialogue before hundreds of avid listeners and peace and justice activists, which challenged us all to continue the journey of a justice seeking a justice that transforms suffering, which will liberate all, both rich and poor alike. As Archbishop Romero said so prophetically just a few weeks before his assassination, the Church's good name is not a matter of being on good terms with the powerful. The Church's good name is a matter of knowing that the poor regard the Church as their own, of knowing that the Church's life on earth is to call on all, the rich, on the rich as well, to be converted and to be saved alongside the poor, for they are the only ones called blessed. Romero, another pastor molded by his experience of being evangelized by the poor, to be able to critically analyze the structures of injustice and oppression in his context, and through his Sunday homilies and his pastoral statements, to create in that context a living theology, which is done at the coalface, which was done at the coalface of his people's experience, and to offer hope, support, solidarity to his people in their tremendous struggles. In contrast to this, the privatization of religion, as it were, coupled with the gospel of prosperity and personal advancement, and even a culture of entitlement, leading to unethical decision-making in the global political and economic arena, means that billions of poor and excluded ones in our world will continue to be left in isolation and loneliness, and so often without hope. In the face of this reality, the church everywhere needs to give witness to an integrity that is prophetic, and to live out of a spirituality that is authentic by committing itself, involving itself in all the sites of suffering in our world, and to do theology at those sites, leading then to authentic praxis. And this may be one of the fruits of the theology and spirituality of the Church of the Global South, which we can share, just share, with our sisters and brothers in the so-called developed North, who need to face the very same question. What in the socio-economic context in Europe and in the UK reveals structures of injustice, marginalization, and exclusion, which impact on the very possibility of people, but especially the most vulnerable in our societies, the very possibility for refugees and economic migrants to experience that they can live in the dignity which is God's dream for them. And what this socio-historical context here calls for is also a renewal in our understanding of the church in mission and of what the mission of evangelization means. Those were the questions relevant for the North as for the South. Those were the questions with which the liberation theologians like Gutierrez and others from Latin America grappled with in their socio-historical context. And those same questions were and are to be grappled with, and still we grapple with, in our socio-historical context in South Africa and indeed the whole African continent. As one of our great South African contextual theologians, the Dominican Albert Nolan, said, suffering must be the new starting point for modern theology and spirituality. In the ever deeper suffering from the atrocities of apartheid, Nolan and others from the ecumenical community were inspired to articulate a prophetic analysis and theology in the Kairos document. The recognition that in such a profoundly unjust system, apartheid, suffering was a Kairos moment, calling for conversion and the overcoming of all the structures of oppression and injustice if our people were to begin living in the freedom of God's children, as they were meant to by God. And this called for a solidarity, a walking with the downtrodden, who are and who always must be empowered and encouraged to be the agents of change in their reality. But our Kairos document in South Africa and its Kairos moment in 1985, inviting the church to prophetic engagement in the struggle against apartheid, has been replicated in the different socio-historical context in the North. The Kairos Palestine document of 2009, written by UK Christians, followed by their Iona call in 2009, in the same spirit, to find the way to peace through justice in the context of suffering. We in the South can learn from and be inspired by that Kairos Palestine initiative, because both ours and theirs were calls for people to identify and engage with the socio-historical reality on the ground, and to discern prophetic action and praxis as a response which still has to be continued because suffering still continues. An icon of our struggle in apartheid and the Kairos call to conversion was Archbishop Dennis Hurley, who likewise moved from the life-changing experience of Vatican II as a church leader and through the ever-increasing brutality of the apartheid regime to becoming a prophet in the midst of the church and society, not without opposition and real cost to him personally. He did this together with other church leaders like Archbishop Desmond Tutu. And these prophetic witnesses, Hurley, Tutu, and others, developed a theology which responded to that critical situation. Archbishop Hurley was the one who motivated our bishops' conference to declare apartheid intrinsically evil. And so he and those other prophetic witnesses led the marches and the protests and engaged in responses to the daily crises which called them forth to prophetic action. It was an example of church leaders doing theology at the coalface of experience, which then moved seamlessly into practice, into active solidarity with the actors who would be involved in transformation. In other words, the very people themselves in the communities who would eventually win their political liberation in South Africa in 1994. Sadly for me, in the closing years of Archbishop Hurley's life, I experienced his pain and his great disappointment at what was done to one of the great loves of his life, ISIL, the International Commission on English in the Liturgy, on what was done to his dream of a liturgical language which would inspire and lead us to a deepening faith. That was truly heartbreaking for him, and I experienced that pain. Now, in South Africa, the great challenge which remains even after 20 years of democracy is economic justice and transformation, which is a much more difficult quest. And that is our problem in the present-day South Africa, and perhaps in many places around the world, and certainly in other countries in Africa, the lack of ethically informed public discussions and policy making and implementation around all that has to do with promoting the common good, especially in terms of the poor and vulnerable. And the absence of an ability and indeed commitment by political leaders to think out of the box, to creatively imagine how things can be different, to imagine differently instead of ideologically. Social justice and the opportunities for a more wholesome life in democracies, especially social democracies, can only be really achieved on the foundation of massive public spending on government-supported programs concerning proper health care, education, including higher education and skills training, safety nets for the poor, such as legal aid, and so on and so on. But the question is, do the political elites in our globalized world know what an ethic of sharing and solidarity actually means in the face of growing inequality in our globalized world? Do they have the political will to legislate ethically for social justice programs and to accept that this will entail real sacrifice? Yes, ethics, economic justice, and transformation. Just as Gustavo Gutierrez's book appeared in 1971, so did the powerful and prophetic challenge of the Synod on Justice in the World appear. Action on behalf of justice, it said, and participation in the transformation of the world fully appear to us as a constitutive dimension of the preaching of the gospel, or, in other words, of the church's mission for the redemption of the human race and its liberation from every oppressive structure. Underlying and informing action for justice must be the spirituality of feeling with, as we see in Jesus, of taking on and participating in the suffering of the little ones. That is the basis of a solidarity which cannot be restricted to thinking of and praying for the poor and afflicted. Important as praying for them in solidarity is, it must move from that to solidarity in action, to sharing with the other, so that they are empowered as actors, as agents, to transform their situation as we journey by their side in support and solidarity in the quest for a more equal world. Much in our world seems to be built on the philosophy of I think, therefore I am, and all the consequences that could flow from that. I say could flow, not necessarily therefore. It all depends on whether or not one stops with I think. I think, therefore I am. In our African culture, we are encouraged to proceed from our proverb, I am because you are. The values of relationship, of building and sustaining community, of sitting under a tree together to analyze and share and look at possibilities which we can implement together. Yes, together, not just individually. This is at the basis of our joyful and vibrant liturgies. For example, as I celebrate a confirmation mass in a community which will last at least 4 hours in the heat, filled with joyful singing and dancing, followed by another couple of hours sharing a meal, and then perhaps a concert by the youth, and then greeting everyone before I stagger exhausted to my car for the journey home. Yes, but so inspired by that experience of faith, of joy in the presence of Jesus and each other in community, that everyone is important, including that little child who wanders up the aisle during the liturgy, away from its mother, and is very soon picked up by someone else, because as another of our proverbs and saying says, your child is our child. Yes, perhaps there are kernels of wisdom and inspiration in this that could be a learning for the developed world. Not to do the same in the same way, but taking the core meaning or focus and translating that into the socio-cultural reality of the North, so that people here can also find a way to deeper meaning and purpose in their lives. But behind this, I am because you are, there is an important conceptual understanding which needs to be applied to North-South relationships and to the whole question or debate on development theory and development aid provided by the rich countries to the underdeveloped world. The humanitarian responses of the developed world and its agencies and organizations in the face of disasters and the flood of refugees from wars and violence is tremendously commendable. This is all about creating and sustaining a globalization of solidarity instead of what Pope Francis calls a globalization of indifference. What liberation and contextual theologies of the South call us to is to take another step or two, to ask the questions, why has this or that happened? What are the causes? What are the reasons behind this violence or that catastrophe of HIV, AIDS, and TB, or that outbreak of cholera, this war, this flood of refugees, and so on and so on? And often the cause is all the complex forms of poverty and impoverishment of people. A doctor in the States, Dr. Farmer, said that disease makes a preferential option for the poor. There are also structural causes or systemic issues behind why certain nations remain trapped in poverty. So the question is, how can the resources of the developed world be used in relationship with the global South, with its resources, in order to help transform the suffering caused by endemic poverty with its many faces? Theories of development and the way development aid is conceptualized and structured perhaps minimize an indispensable factor: the person or community for whom that development aid is being considered, because so much of that aid today goes directly to governments. There may even be an attitude not sufficiently reflected upon that such poor and vulnerable people are in some way inferior because they are the ones in need, and they must therefore be instructed what to do and how to do it. The truth is that the poor and the afflicted and vulnerable often know and can analyze their situation as well as, perhaps even better than, the highly skilled technocrats who may administer development aid. They can also prioritize their needs very well and can analyze what needs to be done, and above all, how a true partnership could actually bring about a transformation in their situation, because they, in the end, must bring about the changes they desire to see. But in addition, the poor do not always have all the resources required to transform endemic poverty and its myriad effects. And this opens the way to developing partnerships based on ethical choices, based on mutual respect, and on listening as equals. In Caritas in Veritate, Benedict XVI emphasized that principle of agency. In development programs, he said, the principle of the centrality of the human person as the subject primarily responsible for development must be preserved. The people who benefit from them, the development programs, ought to be directly involved in their planning and implementation. So any partnership in development programs cannot proceed from a top-down approach, that we, who are well-resourced, can do this for you. Rather, we want to embark on a journey with you and accompany you in view of integral human development, a development which is holistic in its concept and implementation. And that, I trust, is always at central to all our church-based development and humanitarian agencies like CAFOD, Missio, TROCRA, and so on. The other positive aspect of integral human development, as we understand it theologically, is that it can enable a rapprochement between the secular and the sacred. It encourages all involved in the developmental process to find the commonalities between the secular language of development theory and practice and the ethical and theological values of contemporary Catholic social teaching, so that we Christians can begin to understand, interpret, and engage with development practice alongside all the other role players. But that takes time, and perhaps that's not so easy for the technocrats of our world to accept. Time is money, but it is possible. And the huge AIDS program I developed in the diocese with community workers, professional nurses and social workers, and a management team partnered by donor agencies left us to design the response, those donor agencies left us to design the response and the ways the programs would be run. And it's those committed, generous, humble people from the communities, many of them vulnerable women, who make the impossible become possible. One final learning to conclude my reflection that I would like to highlight. And this is what has been termed transitional justice. Transitional justice as a concept and a process emerged from approaches which were developed to contribute to transitions from authoritarianism, wars, and violence towards democracy in Latin American states in the 1980s. If there is to be real and sustainable and holistic peace after a peace agreement, then firstly, the process must identify the underlying causes of war and violence, analyze them, and decide what is to be done. And then the starting point in any transitional justice process is the experience of the victims of war and atrocities. And often any sense of justice for the victims must begin with the recovery of truth. Where are the mass graves? What has happened to my loved ones who have disappeared? Who killed family members and why? What is going to be done in terms of the perpetrators? That recovery of truth has been attempted in various forms of truth commissions around the world, or through research and documentation in which the victims are enabled to recover a sense of their dignity through telling their stories, which are documented and then revealed in public hearings. The church has also been very deeply involved in truth recovery processes in the South, in South Africa, Zimbabwe, Brazil, Colombia, Guatemala, El Salvador, etc. But the truth recovery process will be but one step towards justice and respect for human rights in the future, wherever there have been war and atrocities. The process then confronts the issue of where do we want to place the emphasis? Should it be on retributive justice? In other words, punishment for the perpetrators. For example, in what is happening at the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia in The Hague, or in the trials in Africa concerning the genocide in Rwanda. But increasingly, the discussion is moving from retributive justice to the concept and practice of restorative justice, because the objective must be, in the end, the healing and restoring of communities and societies where relationships have been damaged or even destroyed by war and violence. For example, in what I experienced in Sierra Leone after the vicious civil war with its visible effects to be seen in thousands of people and children with amputated limbs. Restorative justice holds together a threefold commitment. Firstly, to work towards restoring the dignity of those whose human rights have been violated. Secondly, to hold perpetrators accountable, emphasizing the harm they've done and the need for personal restitution, if possible, in the presence of their victims. And thirdly, to create the conditions in which human rights will be respected in the future and to prevent what may cause a return to war and violence, part of which must be institutional reform, such as creating an independent judiciary, allowing for an independent media, creating institutions like a human rights commission, and so on. Archbishop Desmond Tutu, in the context of the South African Truth Commission, said that restorative justice is, quote, concerned not so much with punishment as with correcting imbalances, restoring broken relationships with healing, harmony, and reconciliation. This is all about promoting holistic healing, which may lay the foundations for slowly moving towards the possibility of reconciliation. But only when the victims feel they can even begin to talk about reconciliation, all of which the church has been and should be involved in. Reconciliation in wounded societies after war and violence and atrocities may sometimes have to begin just from an agreement or a commitment on the part of all not to kill each other. From there, you can move forward. And here, the cultural methods of some countries in the South, like Uganda, can be so instructive, using cultural processes of bringing about accountability, remorse, and forgiveness, restitution, and reconciliation between perpetrators and victims in order to heal the affected communities. But restitution for victims as the end of this process cannot be restricted, as it was in South Africa, to a small monetary once-off handout. That really was an awful lacuna in our Truth Commission. Restitution for victims can only really be guaranteed when there is a conscious effort to promote economic justice and transformation of the misery which is the result of wars and violence, to mainstream economic care for those who've suffered, so that the victims can, especially the victims, but all those affected, can begin to live with at least a minimal level of decency and become participants then in transforming gradually the poverty and the suffering which has diminished their dignity. That whole process of transitional justice, as we have shared this and experienced this in the South and the Church of the South, can be shared with countries and situations in the North, which were and are also devastated by wars, atrocities, and violence, and are engaging in their own processes. As church people and peace activists, we can share our stories and our experiences and thus discover together insights and mutual enrichment in the quest for peace, for nonviolence, for justice and reconciliation. For example, as Pax Christi International co-president, I went to Croatia to share my experience, just my story, of the South African Truth Commission experience with the activists and the victims of war in the Balkans, who were trying to establish a regional truth commission for the former Yugoslavia, where some 130,000 people are still missing after the war. It was there that I met the mothers of the disappeared, still traumatized years after the war had ended. They have not found healing, they have not found peace, because they have not found the truth about what happened. And so, in conclusion, I come back to the beginning and to the title of this address, From South to North, Lessons from the Church from the Developing World. Lessons for the Church from the Developing World. I trust that some of my reflections tonight, my own searching in the socio-historical context of the South, has been an invitation to all of us, including myself, to once again drink from our wells, as to use Gustavo Gutierrez's phrase, to drink together from our own wells, South and North, in this one world which God has entrusted to us to make more beautiful, through building the dignity and worth of every human being and through ensuring a sustainable environment and planet to protect and nourish our common heritage and our future. I come back to the words of Father Murad from Homs in Syria, surely an invitation again to me, to all of us in North and South, to come together around witnessing to our ideals which are founded on faith. We open our doors to everyone, even though they might come in to kill us. And we will never stop opening our doors. We can only find safety in God. As Archbishop Oscar Romero reflected so simply for all of us here today, there is a criterion, he said, for knowing whether God is close to us or far away. All those who worry about the hungry, the naked, the poor, the disappeared, the tortured, the imprisoned, about any human suffering, are close to God. Thank you.